Ahora les quiero contar un poco sobre la trayectoria del profesor Sylvester Effinger, profesor de Economía Financiera en la Universidad de Tilburg, Holanda, y profesor visitante de Economía en la Universidad de Harvard. Durante su trayectoria investigativa, ha enfocado sus análisis en la política fiscal y monetaria y a la integración económica y financiera en Europa, siendo profesor visitante en los bancos centrales de Alemania, Japón, Francia e Inglaterra. También ha sido asesor especial del Fondo Monetario Internacional y de la Comisión Europea. Sus publicaciones se encuentran publicadas en las principales revistas científicas como el Journal of Money, Credit and Banking, el Journal of Banking and Finance, el Journal of Public Economics, Oxford Economic Papers, el Open Economies Review y el European Journal of Political Economy. Welcome, Mr. Sylvester.
Thank you very much for your nice introduction. Thank you very much for being here. I want to thank Dr. Santiago Castro for his kind invitation. I was a year ago here at the Convention in June, the Colombian Banking Summit, and it's for me a pleasure to return not only to Colombia, but also especially to Cartagena. And my wife and I are very glad to be here. Thank you very much. The research I will do or will present is, you see my name only there, and that's not appropriate in the sense that the paper was done together with Jonathan Malagón. And the history of that paper is the following. At the Colombian Banking Summit, the Convention, last year, I presented a keynote on risk and liquidity of global financial markets. And I received a lot of questions from people in the audience, what the spillovers will be or could be for, what the spillovers could be for Latin American countries. So I had a big discussion also with Jonathan. I said, Jonathan, we can make a fine paper of this about conventional, unconventional monetary policy by the Federal Reserve System, by the ECB, by the Bank of Japan, and let's test that. Let's test the spillovers from, I would say, the larger central banks, Federal Reserve System, ECB, and Bank of Japan, and what does it mean for Latin American countries? I think these are very important questions. And the nice thing of that is, you know, Jonathan is always so enthusiastic that, you know, it was right away a fine cooperation, and Jonathan did, of course, a lot of the estimations. The professor doesn't have always the time for that. You know how that goes. And I'm very grateful to Jonathan that we could work together on this fine paper. Okay, so here we go. And I have a lot of slides, so I have to be very, I have to accelerate now. Here we have, okay, otherwise I take this mic. Here we have the introduction. I will stand here, that's easier for you. The introduction is very brief. Here we go to the crisis, 2008, 2009. It was financial, it originated in the developed economies, especially the US, and of course this was the crisis which was, I would say, the strongest since the Great Depression. If we look to the monetary policy rates here, you see the major central banks, so the Eurozone, US, and also Japan, and you see also that these interest rates went to the negative domain. And what we can notice there is that The options for central banks were limited. Yes.
It works now? Okay, thank you. That you see that the options for central banks were limited and that they had to go from conventional monetary policy to non-conventional, unconventional monetary policy because of the zero bound. Okay, then what could they do? And here you see also another problem. You would expect that this problem would be solved by fiscal policy. But of course, the fiscal policy was not possible because the fact that there was a fiscal deficit in the US of more than 12%, enormous debt to GDP ratio in Japan, and more than 200% here, and of course the fiscal deficit in the Eurozone. That had to do, of course, with the fact that the Eurozone was also confronted with the constraints of the Stability and Growth Pact, which is not always taken that seriously, I must say. But then there was only one option, that the central bank would take over. And what happened? The central bank took over. Here you see developed economies like the US, Eurozone economy, and Japan moved to unconventional monetary policy. Unconventional, which is not only unusual, but also, I would say, beyond their mandate sometimes in the case of the ECB. It's within the mandate of the Federal Reserve System because they have the twin objective of low inflation and of increasing output and employment. Now here we see the total assets of the US, Eurozone and Japan central banks. Now you see that it started with 100 and it's now quadrupled. Can you imagine? So that means that 40% of GDP is in terms of securities on the balance sheets of those central banks. That's not only unconventional, it's even bizarre. And here you see the division. So the US was, of course, the first to do that. Then Bank of Japan, but when the Japanese do something like that, they do it well. And then here you have the European Union, and European Union started late, so it's behind the curve. Welcome, Jonathan, you missed the nice words I devoted to you. But anyhow. So here we see the division and the size of this unconventional monetary policy. Now, two results of QE in US, Eurozone, and Japan. So unconventional monetary policy has maybe been successful, especially in the first rounds. The first round of QE was more successful than QA2 and QA3. And why? Because it's announcement effect which matters. If the central bank enters the capital market, buying bonds and giving liquidity, the money market is small, but the capital market is enormous. So the announcement effect, the expectation channel, the signaling channel, how you want to call it, is very important. That is the reason why the first round of QE was in the US, but also in the Eurozone, more successful than the later rounds of QE. And of course, the larger liquidity had significant effects on emerging financial markets. And Latin America was not an exception to that. Okay, there we go. Question, hypothesis. Now, the question we wanted to investigate is there a differential incidence between conventional and unconventional monetary policy of developed economies on Latin American financial markets? That's the big question. Do we see the difference? Now, here we have the incidence on Latin American financial markets measured in four dimensions. So two are related to asset prices and two other are related to interest rates. Let me take you through this. So here you have this monitor. You have a conventional part. You have some unconventional parts. Here you have the financial market. There is one caveat: Brazil, Mexico, Colombia, Chile, and Peru. you know that this group of seven larger countries, there were two countries which had not, well, reliable statistical information. Venezuela, you can understand that maybe, and Argentina. It's not very shocking in that sense. And here you see the asset prices, fixed income market, and equity market. And here you see the interest rates, monetary policy rates, and active interest rates in terms of lending rates. So both aspects. The hypothesis, what were the hypotheses which were interesting? First hypothesis, conventional, unconventional monetary policy in developed economies have a similar as statistically significant incidence on Latin American fixed income markets, bond markets. Second, conventional, unconventional monetary policy in developed economies have a similar as statistically significant incidence on Latin American equity markets. Third, in Latin American countries where the exchange rate pass-through is low, but both conventional and unconventional monetary policy have null or low incidence on monetary policy and credit market rates, lending rates. In Latin American countries where the exchange rates pass-through, that is the fourth hypothesis, high transmission mechanism of monetary are not blocked conventional, unconventional monetary policy in developed economies have statistically significant effect on interest rates, both monetary policy rates and lending rates. In contrast, unconventional monetary policy is to be expected to have no effects on the interest rates. And then fifth, since the US is the main trading and commercial partner of Latin America, the financial spillovers monetary policy of the Fed are expected to be greater than the ECB and Bank of Japan. And the last, free trade agreements between developed and Latin American economies are likely to exacerbate the financial spillovers of international monetary policy. Those are the six hypotheses. Now, literally, I will skip that a little bit because of sake of time, because I always arrive in negative time. We have negative interest rates, and I always arrive in negative time, and I try to minimize that. So here we have the literature, commercial channel or trade channel, exchange rate channel, credit channel, portfolio rebalancing channel, signaling channel, financial markets channel, and liquidity channel. You see that these channels are mostly important for the interest rate, of the interest rates, and these three channels mostly important for the asset prices here, and then there's one, the liquidity channel, which is mostly important for both of them. Okay. Well, I will skip this. Otherwise, you can read it. Otherwise, I'm, you know, I don't want. Of course, I'm a professor, but I don't want to have a whole exposé of the literature. Okay, the methodology. Variables. This is very. So we have, of course, exogenous variables, so explanatory variables, you could call that. Conventional monetary policy, which is in this case defined as the 1-year government bond yield. Unconventional monetary policy, monthly asset purchases by central banks. Then we have the endogenous variables, so the depending variables, if you like to. So the bond market, fixed income market, equity markets, monetary policy rate, so, and of course the active interest rate, credit market interest rate or lending rate. You see that those are defined by the 10-year government bond yield, stock market index, monetary policy rate, and nominal active interest rates. And here are the sources, you can see that. And of course, we have tried to have comparable proxies for that. Oh, that's too fast. Control variables. Control variables are necessary to make a good estimation of that. Of course, which you always find in those controls are the CDS prices. That's normal. CDS is more or less a kind of measure of systemic risk. However, be aware that CDS prices nowadays are less informative than in the past, because CDS prices are sometimes used by central bankers and financial supervisors information about systemic risk. And then you get the Lucas critique, or good or slow, that if you use that information, the value of that information, CDS prices, as a measure of systemic risk, becomes less. And so be aware that you often have to be cautious. Then this market volatility indicator, VIX, this is from the Chicago Board Options, that measures the volatility in the market. Of course, the output gap, difference between actual and potential GDP, inflation gap, difference between actual inflation and target inflation rate, oil prices, commercial integration, you could say trade integration if you prefer that. So it is for free trade agreements, a dummy. I will come to that. It's not so successful, and I will explain you why. But it's necessary as a control variable, and then the effect of the pass-through, also measured by a dummy. Open calculations. So here we have also some new item. That's the shadow rates. And let me explain a little bit about the shadow rates. I don't know if everybody is aware about the shadow rates, but it's a very important issue by Wu and Xia. It goes back to 1995, Fisher Black. He was the first who spoke about shadow rates. The point is that you have the zero lower bound. You cannot go in the negative domain with your nominal interest rates. But if you have, for example, quantitative easing, the effective interest rate goes in the negative domain. And how do you measure that? Well, you can measure that with all kinds of forward rates. Wu and Xia, I can really recommend, did that, for example, for the Federal Reserve System. So when the effective Federal Reserve rate was, between zero and 25 basis points, and you cannot go below zero, then how do you measure then the effective interest rate in the negative domain with the QE exercise? So, and here you see this is very nice. Here you see that period where the Fed was, at the zero lower bound, and then you see here the shadow rate. Here you see the AONIA, that's the money market interest rate in the Eurozone, which is comparable with the federal funds rate. And you see here that, of course, the AONIA went to zero, but the shadow rates really tumbled in the negative domain. So that's also a kind of benchmark for the effect of conventional and unconventional monetary policy. Question is, but that's a very difficult question, are both policies independent, orthogonal, as econometricians will say? That's a very difficult question to answer, like the symmetry and the asymmetry in the expansionary and restrictive phase. But that's maybe something for the future. Okay, then we go here to the approaches. I will do that also very briefly. Here you have the panel data approach. What is panel data? Very simple. Cross-section time series. You maximize the number of observations. It's with five countries and limited number of observation in time, it's the best you can do. And by the way, it's one of my favorite approaches. Why? Because you know what you're doing. That's something different than if you go to a factor autoregressive model, or what now people like to do at central banks, DGSE models, makes no sense because you don't think anymore. It's measurement without a theory. And like Chaling-Kopmans once said, measurement without theory, because you have to have a kind of a hypothesis. You have to have something you want to test, a hypothesis. In our case, six hypotheses. And the moment you put everything in the computer and then especially when you measure only the first and second moment exposed with value at risk structural VAR models or DGS-E models, then you lose a lot of information. So here, the differential effect of developed economies, spillovers over Latin American countries, age specifications, what you see here, so the endogenous variables, so here are the variables and linked to the exogenous variables. Now let me explain here, bonds, equity prices, monetary policy rate, active rate, lending rates, again, and here you find the conventional monetary policy, C, and here you find the unconventional monetary policy, US, EU, Eurozone, and Japan. So that's the structure, and here you find all the control variables. So that's the structure of how it's done, how it's cooked. You always have to explain the recipe book. Okay, the robustness check is also possible because I spoke already about the shadow rates. Very interesting to check the shadow rates, but the problem is there are no shadow rates for Japan. They're not available. They're only available for US, EU. So here, the bond rate, shadow rates, equity rates, monetary policy rates, and active rates. So, and here the control variables. So that's the structure. That's just a robustness check. It's a robustness check of the test of the asset purchases. Now, this is already a nice picture where you summarize everything with the dots. Here you have direct, significant, and strong effect. That's the real green dot. Direct, significant, but weak effect in terms of coefficient. Indirect and insignificant. Now, here, fixed income market, equity market, monetary policy rate, lending, interest rate, conventional monetary policy, so the interest rate policies, unconventional monetary policy part one, that's monthly purchases of bonds, government bonds, and sometimes corporate bonds in the case of the ECB. And here the testing of unconventional monetary with shadow rates. Now, what is the outcome? You see that conventional has strong effects, of course, on fixed income markets and monetary policy. That's not surprising. But what you see is unconventional monetary policy, both by the monthly asset purchases and measured by the shadow rates, have, in most cases, direct, significant, strong influence on the bond market and the equity market, and in this case, a direct, significant, but weaker effect on the fixed income. But they all have a direct and significant effect. It's very important to see that. Results. Now, first, this is the question, what is the differential incidence? Conventional, that's the main question. There we go. So first, this. What is the outcome of this? Now, forget the equation. There is a statistically significant relation between the conventional monetary policy in the US, Eurozone, on Latin America, long-term interest rate, the bond market. The effect of conventional monetary policy in Japan is statistically not significant. And then here you see the coefficients which are explained, but I won't elaborate because of the sake of time. Otherwise I go in the negative domain, and we don't want it. So conventional monetary on equity markets. So the relationship between conventional monetary policy in the US and Eurozone and Latin American equity prices is indirect. This is observed through long-term rates of sovereign bonds, government bonds of the region. The effect of conventional monetary policy in Japan is statistically significant. And then here you see the effects if you're interested in that. I suppose that this presentation is also available for people if they want to. Jonathan? If you want the presentation, you can ask Jonathan for that, or Selma. Yeah. Okay, so then we have here conventional monetary policy on monetary policy rates, there we go. There's significant relationship between conventional monetary policy, US, Eurozone, and Latin American monetary policy rates, but the effect is low. Incident of conventional monetary in Japan is not significant. That's also understandable because of the trade and financial relations with Japan are limited. Yes, I know, I see it, yeah. That means that we see that there's effect from US, Fed, the Federal Reserve System. We see that there's effect from the Eurozone, but Japan is negligible, that you can forget. Okay, then conventional monetary policy to the lending rates, very important. Here's the result, relationship between conventional monetary policy in US, Eurozone, and Latin American lending rates is indirect. It's observed through monetary policy rates. Effect of conventional monetary policy, again, for Japan, is not significant. Now we go to unconventional monetary policy for the fixed income market. Here we have it. There is a significant relationship between unconventional monetary policy in US and Eurozone and the long-term rates in Latin America, but the effect is very low. The incidence is not significant for Japan. Now we go to the equity markets. Relationship between unconventional monetary policy, US and Eurozone and Latin American equity price, direct, that means, it's very important, that there is asset price inflation. So the asset prices in Latin America are blown up by QE, for example, of the Federal Reserve, and later on by ECB policies. So that's important to make a proper interpretation of these asset prices. Here, the effects on the monetary policy rate. So there you see that unconventional monetary policy and the policy rates not significant, and lending rates is also not significant, which you already would expect. Okay, results, robustness check exercises. There we go. Now using the shadow rates, and you know the shadow rates are meant to measure the effect not only of conventional monetary policy, so at the zero lower bound, you cannot go in the negative domain. I can go in the negative domain with my time, but the central banks cannot do that. That means that you have to measure the effects of asset market purchases, quantitative easing, for the interest rate, what they would have been. Now, you see using shadow rates as a measure of unconventional monetary policy, you find the same results as before. So it's robust. That's important to understand, robust. So this a clear relationship, not only in asset market purchases, but also in shadow rates. Here we find the effect with equity prices, and which is clear that the shadow rates in the US are significant. However, in the Eurozone, not significant. We have to think about it. But maybe the reason is that in the US, the trade and financial relations, that could be the one explanatory factor in that. And the second one, the US Federal Reserve started earlier with the whole process of QE, of asset market purchases. That means, of course, that maybe the measurement of the effect for the equity price in Latin America, you should have longer series, beyond 2016. Previous estimates, now the relation between unconventional monetary policy, US, etc., and interest rate is not relevant. And then we come to the conclusions, and I see that I'm still in positive time, so that's remarkable. But then I use my time and go a little bit in the negative domain, if I may. So here we have the conclusions. Conclusions about the first hypothesis. So you see that these fixed income markets are really influenced by unconventional monetary policy. That means that the globalization in terms of monetary policy, especially of unconventional monetary policy, is really a serious affair. However, fixed income effect is low, but it's significant. Same way, conventional and unconventional monetary policy have, and that's important, strong effect and significant effect on the equity markets. That's important to know how you make the interpretation of these asset prices. There is asset price inflation. So be very careful with that, with the interpretation of these prices. And then, unlike the third hypothesis, who you know that was about the exchange rate pass-through, that's not significant, that has not important meaning. You see also that both in both cases, exchange rate pass-through was not relevant for the endogenous variables. So let's go to the conclusion, the last set of conclusions. Conventional and unconventional monetary policy in you have a greater effect than the Eurozone. Yes, I'm almost ready. And that is explainable by the trade and financial flows, which are with the US much more important. However, it's changing. Trade and financial flows with the Eurozone are increasing. That means that the effect in the future, in terms of globalization of monetary policy, both conventional and unconventional, will increase for Latin America. And then we have the, sorry. Then we have the hypothesis six about the free trade agreements. Not as controls, they were meant as controls, but not so important. And why not so important? The reason is the following. It's like capital market restrictions. People always look to capital market restrictions. I did a lot of work on capital market restrictions. Those are dummies, 0-1. That doesn't matter anything. Because capital market restrictions may be there, but not effective. It's much better to look to covered and uncovered interest parity. Covered interest parity is a much better measure for capital market restrictions than the restrictions as such, because they don't necessarily have to be effective. The same applies to these free trade agreements. They may be there, but not effective. And what you want to measure is the effective commercial trade integration. That's what you want to measure. So be very aware about interpretation of that. And then the last, and then I'm finished. That's, of course, a very interesting conclusion. Of course, the financial markets in Latin America are influenced by QE in the US and QE in the Eurozone. But there's good news, eh? There's the good news. The good news is that the shocks, the vulnerability to external shocks in Latin America has become less, has diminished. And then the question is, how do we explain that? Now, one is maybe the macroprudential policies there, but also the monetary policy rules. And I think that has also to do with the fact that Latin American countries have learned that they need to reduce their vulnerability to, I would say, the shocks coming from the US and shocks coming from the Eurozone. And I think that's good news. And I think the Latin American countries, central banks, should continue on that path. Thank you very much.